on.
Brian.
Welcome to a new America.
I know. It's like New Year's Day should be recalibrated as January 20th. We'll leave the initial few days aside as kind of leftovers. Leftovers of 2020.
I love it. I love it. In fact, John, being that I'll be in the Bay Area soon, maybe we could have a safe, distanced champagne toast and celebration of a new America, a new year, a new year actually for intersections. So very, very excited to plan with you this year.
Yeah, big year. A lot of interesting plans.
Well, welcome everybody to another episode of Intersections. This show is partly amazing because of the incredible guests we have, but also amazing because of you, your participation, the questions and your comments along the way. So please do share with us a number of things at any moment during the show, where you're tuning in from, what you're working on, who has your attention. Also, if you have questions or comments for our guests, please share and we'll do our best to get to them and also feature them in real time on our feed. Intersections is a weekly conversational jam session. I just love saying that, that dives deep into the intersections among technology, innovation, culture, and ideas. We bring diverse personalities and worldviews together in service of the greater understanding, in greater service of understanding and also unlearning. I'd like to introduce my co-host, the wonderful and incredible human being, John Kao. The Economist has called him Mr. Creativity. He's a serial innovator. He's a thought leader, entrepreneur, advisor, a brilliant musician, just an all-around wonderful person. He's taught at Harvard Business School. He's served as a visiting faculty at MIT Media Lab at Stanford. He's a Tony-nominated producer of film and stage, and he wrote the best-selling Jamming, the Art and Discipline of Business Creativity. He also chairs the Institute for Large-Scale Innovation. One of these days, we're going to put John on the spot to play for us live. Maybe you'll hear it in the background. He has a piano tuner visiting. John, welcome to Intersections.
Brian, so great. I'm going to hit the ball right back over the net. Playing at the net with you is always so much fun. So Brian Solis, my erstwhile partner, co-founder, and friend, is someone who's been a pioneer in many respects, stitching together the emergence of the digital domain with innovation, with marketing, with the enterprise. He's a polymath. He communicates in many media. He's a rock star keynote speaker of many years repute, serial author, thought leader, productizing his output and being able to track it in real time is always an amazing challenge. And he has actually a formal title, which is Global Innovation Evangelist for Salesforce. So here we are.
Here we are. Thank you for that, John. Actually, I want to go back a couple of names here on the comments just to send a shout out to Pat in Colorado. This is my brother-in-law. Hey, Pat, happy New Year. I was thinking about you. Give me a call. Let's catch up. John, so why don't we just jump right into it? And we got an action-packed show as always. Maybe you can tee up our first guest.
Sure. So Gary Bowles is someone I've known for going on 20 years. In San Francisco, we have what sociologists would call kind of an invisible college of thought leaders who are at the edge of the so-called new economy and technology and so forth and so on. And Gary's been right in the middle of all of that. I see him at meetings. I see him at dinners. I see him walking down the street. And I see him in a professional capacity. He's a serial intellectual entrepreneur, I would say, currently the chair for the future of work at Singularity University. He's a partner at a consulting firm called Charette LLC and also the co-founder of something called eParachute.com, which may in some respects relate to his late father's famous work, What Color Is Your Parachute? So Gary's all about the future of work, about learning, about organizations. He's been a big advocate for the topic of navigating through the Great Reset, and is also an advocate for inclusive capitalism. So that's about 3 hours worth of topics for us to talk about, I would say.
I was going to say we have nothing to talk about.
Yeah. So, Brian, do you want to kick off or do you want me to jump in?
Well, why don't you lead this time? But I will say, Gary, it's great to see you. Thank you for
being
here.
You too. We've got a long history as well, Brian. So from collaborating on events like Nokia's retreats, and it's great to see you as well.
Yes, like a small family reunion. John?
Yeah. Right, inside baseball here. So I guess I'd like to start by inquiring as to how your work on the Great Reset is going. You know, you carved out, a very useful and ambitious territory earlier on in the pandemic. I noted with some interest that, our friend Klaus Schwab started talking about the Great Reset. I wondered if that came about through conversations or just, kind of intellectual resonance. But regardless, how's your work in the Great Reset going? And given the fact that everybody's talking about disruption and dislocation and so on, what are you seeing that's, maybe a little bit different from the pack?
So and I appreciate you asking, John. It's great to see both of you. So what I saw March of last year, as I think we're all just trying to figure out what the heck was going on, that there actually seemed to be some similar patterns to some of the big whack to the side of the head that we've taken in terms of for society and economies in recent decades. And it seemed like they kind of all had sort of same arc. There was a initial phase of falling off the cliff phase where just tremendous uncertainty. We actually launched our SOCAP, Social Capital Markets, the entrepreneur and investor conference during the Great Recession, I think right at the beginning of the Great Recession, just as Lehman was melting down. So there's this falling off the cliff phase where nobody knows what's going on, 100% uncertainty. Then there's a second phase that's kind of a riffling along the bottom. It's a fever chart where, it seemed predictable last March that we were going to have places where the sort of Venn diagram of the infection rates, the impact on industry, the impact on geographies, the impact on different work roles, all that was going to add up. And there were going to be places where people were going to get their handle on the ball very quickly. Others where they turned the lights on, they got to turn the lights off again. And so it was going to be this period of continual uncertainty, of flux. Hopefully is a third phase, and actually some countries are seeing this. Some countries that have gotten the handle on the ball are seeing this third phase of thriving to put the pieces back together of their economy, although I think last year only China had a positive GDP. But that seemed to be, so I wrote this piece called The Great Reset and published it at economy.com, our friend David Kirkpatrick. And then a couple of months later, I saw that Klaus and his team had chosen it as their theme, and I'm sure they're completely disconnected. I'm sure there's no, the phone didn't ring off the hook from the World Economic Forum group. But I think we were seeing some of the same similarities. What I felt was going to be different was a couple things. First off, I showed, in the same way that much of the visuals of last March and April were the spike of infection rates, I showed the slump. Yeah, thanks. I appreciate you showing that. So the slump was from past impacts like this, you could kind of see that there were the sort of a series of waves that were going to happen. You're going to get impacts on industries and organizations. You're going to get impact on employment, and then you're going to get impact on municipalities. Those waves seem to happen over and over again. So in industry, if you remember the 2000 meltdown, same thing, big impact on industries, lots of unemployment, and then basically communities had a hard time because they were, a number of them were hit in an outsized way. And so that's what I was saying is, well, we need to, there's another graphic that I showed where I actually, when I do lectures that I showed, when I was doing lectures last March and April, where I'd show the second, what would flattening the slump look like? Just like we were trying to flatten the curve of the infection rate. And I showed actually two stimulus pops because you needed, one was, it's like defibrillators. One, you see it, whenever you see the hospital shows, they never do it once. It's at least two or three times, right? So because it turns out you never get it right. Like you don't understand exactly all the dynamics. Economies are so complicated. So I focused specifically on employment because I said, if we can keep people employed, looking at governments like Germany's, you know, in the U.S., what we saw was we literally tripled our unemployment rate from 5 to 15% in 2 months. Germany went from 5% to 5.7% unemployment. I mean, it was just a blip because they've made very different decisions about their economy. So since then, I ended up, you know, I always say the future of work was theory up until January 2020, and then by March it was practice. So I did 100 lectures and interviews last year because what I was trying to help people understand is there are actually things we can do. We can make decisions now to both create much more inclusion so that we have less of an impact, and we can create a better tomorrow if we make some of the right decisions today.
Well, let's talk about that. So what is the future of work in this period of discontinuity, and what are some of the wise policy decisions that change the game board for the common good?
So I always say this when I talk about the future of work. So first off, I never call myself a futurist, which is kind of odd since it's, you know, my title's the chair for the future of work. I'm much more of a, it's the near, you know, near, like today. Most of the questions people have is not, will robots and software take all of our jobs in 20 years? That's not really what they're asking. Is it's what should I do today, or what should I be telling my kid to do today if they're entering into the job market? So what I try to help people sort of frame is there's four domains for the future of work: individuals, organizations, communities, and countries. And so when you talk about policy, that typically is, well, what can countries do to try to, you know, sort of insulate the shocks and make more inclusive economies? But communities can do things to actually build much more inclusive ecosystems. Organizations can have policies where they actually don't lay people off in times of challenges. They try to actually help them to focus on new problems. And then individuals, there's lots of things that we can be doing to try to help develop agency and access, right? Those are kind of the two things that you want. You want people to feel like they've got the power to do something, and you want to feel like they're, if they do something, that there is going to be a positive outcome, like they might actually get a job and might keep their job. And so at writ large, what you want is you want ecosystem strategies, no matter what part of this you feel you have influence over, even if it's only for yourself or for people in your sphere, that you can help them to be able to find or create meaningful, well-paid work. If you're in an organization, if you hire one person and you hire a more diverse candidate, somebody that doesn't look like you or doesn't have your background than you might have done otherwise, you've had a huge impact. With communities, how you can build the connective tissue between communities so that they can actually have a thesis as to what the future value they want to create is. And I could give you example after example of communities around the world that are doing exactly that, because, for instance, tourism has been destroyed in so many places. There are communities that are going through the process of figuring out what will we need to be tomorrow to be able to continue to thrive. And then at the policy level, there's some pretty important decisions that countries need to make. The reason that Germany and the Nordics were reasonably insulated against this is that they actually, at the intersection of a society and economy, they made a number of decisions in recent years. In Germany, it was the Hartz, the variety of policies that were put into place with the Hartz initiatives. After the German unification in the late 1990s, that actually laid the groundwork for them to be a more resilient economy today. And those are, you know, that's very visible. Those are very visible decisions that other economies can make as well.
So there's a lot of discussion about algorithmic marketplaces that will link people in terms of their credentialed skills to opportunities, whether it's at the higher education level of finding an internship or a summer job, or whether it's the mid-career person, et cetera, et cetera. And I guess the goal is to create a lot more efficiency in terms of, and effectiveness in terms of, just matching more precisely what people have to offer with what the labor market requires. What do you think about that overall approach? I mean, are you enthusiastic about it? Do you see some dark shadows in there? Do you think it's a bunch of, you know, corporate hype at this point? Or do you think it's a solution to some of the kind of policy challenges that we just described?
Yeah. So the answer is yes. Okay. All the above, right?
So you're hedging your bets here.
It is both solution and curse. So here's why. So if you're going to simplify this stuff, basically two-sided work markets, which is essentially what we're talking about, right? Two-sided work markets. Amazon is a two-sided product and service market, but you know, two-sided work markets have three players. Supply, that's us, messy, expensive humans. Demand, that's the hirer. I don't say employer, but hirer. And the platform. Two out of three win all the time. And that's the hirer and the platform. And what happens is in efficient markets that don't have something that monkeys with the design heuristics to ensure that humans continue to make a reasonable amount of income is that there's downward compression on wages because, as you've seen with Amazon, you get cheaper and cheaper stuff because the marketplace is very efficient. Yeah, again, efficient. Well, efficient marketplaces, when it comes to humans, the most efficient marketplace uses robots and software because then you don't need messy, expensive humans. And so with downward compression on wages and with continuing automation, so long as we continue to be driven by shareholder primacy, that's what you're going to find is you're going to see those markets that are continually going to be biased. And the people that will do well on the platforms are the best. That is the people who have the most agency, the highest skill set. So if you look at Toptal or if you look at the dynamics of Upwork or any of those markets, the good news is there are some people that have access to work that they would never have had before, can do it from anywhere, and have amazing lives, and the long tail has less. And so what we're seeing is a shift towards, and what I encourage decision makers inside of organizations, outside organizations, in governments, is to think about the ways that you actually design these marketplaces so that everybody wins. And so there's so if you want some good examples, read the book, The Inside Gig by Kelly Stephen Wace. And she talks about how large corporations can actually build very efficient marketplaces internally to both uncover the skill set of their workers and then help them to link up to solving problems for their stakeholders much more effectively. And then if you want examples of how governments are actually starting to leverage these marketplaces to provide more value to their constituents, look at beyondjobs.com, what Wing and Rowan is doing and helping governments to actually build their own marketplaces to benefit their citizens. They're designing those marketplaces in a way that actually ensures that the supply, the humans, actually make a good wage.
It's really interesting what you're saying because the dystopian scenario is that these market spaces become instruments for increasing the social divide and social inequity because you've got the digital serfs who are, you know, salaried at the pennies up and down level. And then you've got the one percenters who are using this as a further extension of their privilege. So, you know, we could go on like this for hours, as we said earlier. But Brian, what's on your mind with regard to what Gary's been talking about?
A lot. Maybe we could add a couple hours. I did want to highlight how Gary closed out his article in The Great Reset, No Human Left Behind. And I think that is a tremendous thing to say. And it's also a tremendous thing to now operationalize around. I don't know, Gary, what you think. You know, as being a digital anthropologist for so many years, I was always surprised at how very little the role of human beings played as we consider technology in digital transformation, as we consider technology in innovation. Now you have this great reset where we have to have some really hard conversation. You know, we saw 10 years of AI and automation accelerate in just the last year alone. As you said earlier, this brings up the conversation of, you know, what does that mean for me? And I think we have to sort of spin that in a much more optimistic sense of, you know, this is a real opportunity for human beings to, as we say on the show, unlearn and learn forward. What is the best advice that you can share with leaders to really consider the balance of one, technology, but two, the silent voices that we don't hear from our workforce into the role that they can play in the future success of organizational transformation?
Yeah, absolutely. So I have not yet joined the ranks of the author class. I'm working on that right now. You guys are way ahead of me. So my first book is called The Next Rules of Work. which comes out in August, and I'm delivering the manuscript in 2 weeks. So,
congratulations.
So that's very top of mind, some of the key themes. But basically, my framing, what I try to help those who lead organizations, I honestly don't use the word leader and leadership all that much, because I think we kind of, my friend Steve Deming, the author of The Age of Agile, he talks a lot about how we've sort of lost our way in agreeing what leadership actually even means in the first place. So I often say those who lead, right? So, because that can mean anything. It could be anybody at any level or any role within the organization. So, but I often tell those who lead organizations is that, you know, I essentially think of there as being three anchors or sort of three legs of the stool. Mindset, skill set, and tool set. So when you started talking about technology, what happens is transformation, you can walk into any one of these doors that you want. You can bring the tool set, and those of us who grew up in Silicon Valley, we tend to think first with the tool set. Oh, if we just put enough digital stuff in place, everything works out well. Well, how's that working out for us right now? Let's talk about social media. So now the tool set, actually, let's work instead on the skill set. Let's make sure everybody has the skills that they need. Let's get lots of AI programmers. Well, actually, no, you get these market asymmetries, like these market mismatches. There's all the skills that we don't think we need as much, and there's all the new skills, and we just aren't very good. Most countries aren't very good at helping people to be able to develop those skill sets. All right, so maybe what we really need to start with is mindset, culture, with the way that we think and act. And so for those who lead organizations, what I say is, well, so really what you're trying to do, what you need to do, the deliverable has to be that there's a mindset. There's a mindset that you want to encourage throughout your organization. And if you keep on coming with a traditional approach to leadership, which is essentially you're the ones that have all the answers, like you're the ones that are going to just tell people, here's where we're going. You go off to the retreat. You know, now it'll be a virtual Zoom retreat with the leadership, you know, which is normally like the box in an organization. And you're going to come up with what the direction of the organization is. And then you're going to bring them like the tablets from the mount to tell to your people. Then it does fail, because really what you've got is a tremendous range of people if you can help them to develop the right mindset, the growth mindset that allows them to be continually adaptive and agile, then they're going to help you to continually solve problems and generate value for the organization stakeholders today and tomorrow. So it actually takes behavior change on the part of those who lead organizations. And I find that is a big barrier. Because it does mean that you've got to be more transparent. As Jeff Weiner said at LinkedIn says, you've got to have more compassion. It does mean that you have to be more inclusive. You have to embrace diversity. You have to embrace people who challenge your perspective and make all of that work in the context of co-creation. And if there's any point in our history where we've seen many of the strictures that we had on the ways that we used to run organizations, COVID blew that apart, right? We used to have people. I mean, how many organizations actually had work from home policies before COVID? How many said there is no way we will ever trust our workers? I call it management by surveillance. How will we ever trust our workers to get their work done if we let them go home? And so what I tell those who lead is you've got to step back and you have to look at what does authentic leading in this era mean? And what that means is a set of processes for determining what the purpose of the organization is, and then building the alignment processes that ensure that it's fractal throughout the organization. And if you want, you know, great examples, look at Asana, look at what they've done in terms of the way that they have what I think is an alignment engine that continually keeps the organization in sync with delivering value to its stakeholders.
Oh my gosh. Our producer is telling us we're out of time, and I've got so many more questions for you, Gary.
Where we live in.
All right. Well, I actually have an idea that I'll share with John, and then I'll circle back with you, Gary, on how we can continue this conversation.
Great.
And thank you so much for being on the show. I think if it's one thing that I've learned from 2020 and heading into 2021 is that the future of work isn't what it used to be. And we have... We have some new things to focus on. So, Gary,
the future isn't what it used to be either.
It's so true.
So I hear.
So true. Oh, Gary, thank you so much. Thank you so much for being on the show. Thank you for
great to see you guys. Thanks everybody for watching. Be well.
Take care,
John. I don't know what to do with all these notes and questions that I have now. We're gonna have to. We're gonna brainstorm soon. So I am so excited I'm actually giddy, if I can say that, to welcome our next guest. There, Jennifer Acker is actually been a longtime friend of mine, and we had her father on, David, recently, and so we're keeping it in the family, John. That's what we do here. So I'll just go ahead and introduce Jennifer and Naomi quickly, and we'll welcome to the show. So Naomi Bagdonis, Jennifer Acker, I've co-authored a new book. Their backgrounds are actually quite incredible, and I'll do my best to kind of give you a high level overview. But they have a new book that's out. It's called Humor Seriously, and the book reveals how humor works and changes the way we do business. I think maybe to just jump right in, Naomi, we'll start with you. Just kind of give us a quick background of how you got here before the book, and then we'll jump into the book. And Jennifer, I'll ask the same of you. Welcome, by the way.
Thank you. We're so excited to be here. So my background, I spent a decade straddling corporate strategy and comedy. So on nights and weekends, I was doing improv comedy. And by day, I was designing and facilitating innovation sessions for groups of executives from, you know, board retreats to corporate offsites. And so for a while, these parts of my life lived very separately. And I was sort of very serious at work and very fun on the weekends. And I started to notice how merging those two worlds could actually be really powerful, could unlock more innovation in my clients, and also just have a lot more joy at work. So now Jennifer and I teach together at Stanford's Graduate School of Business, courses about the power of humor in business.
Awesome. And Jennifer, over to you.
Well, first of all, Brian, it's great to know that you're giddy. That is one of the best compliments we have heard so far. So we will take that. John, I don't know if you can also like chime in and say, are you like giddy, joyful, looking forward to it? But anything there, we really like the compliments.
Well, I would characterize my state of mind as kind of a frisson of anticipation.
Wow. These are both the best descriptors.
I don't know if you want to upgrade your response.
Leave it to John. You know, I'm going to stick with giddy, though. It's
okay. Well, we love that. We like both responses. A little bit of background on me and how I got interested in this topic. I, as you know, Brian, wrote this book with my husband called The Dragonfly Effect about 8 years ago. And the idea in that book was about how do you make positive change happen in the world, harnessing the power of story and also social networks. And so we thought it would be interesting to actually put the book to work for the year. And so instead of really focusing on selling books, we really focused on getting people into the bone marrow registry, because the signature story for that book was really about one of my students' best friends who had leukemia and didn't find a match in the registry. So we sort of put story and social networks to work to see if we could find more matches for people who didn't have them. It just felt interesting to, like, instead of doing academic work all the time or, you know, writing books or selling books, how do you maybe help to save the life of even just one person? So when you put that out there in the world, what happens is a lot of people think you're potentially an expert in the area of finding a match for their child or their parent or their grandparent. And so we worked with about 12 Stanford students for a year, trying to find matches for about 17 different people over the course of that year. And a lot of times we were too late. A lot of times we did find matches, but they didn't take. For one individual out of the 17, we were able to find a match. It did take. And one thing that was so powerful about witnessing this over the course of the year is this guy named Amit Gupta. I don't know if you know him. He's an entrepreneur. He created a company named Photo Jojo. He had so much levity. He was easy to laugh. His entire team at Photo Jojo harnessed humor and levity at their work, but also when he was diagnosed with leukemia and they needed to find a match in the registry, they, with my students, leveraged humor in incredible ways. They got comedians to do PSAs of how to get into the registry. And so after that year, I really reflected on what was it about Amit, what was it about that experience that made him not only so effective, but so joyful to work with? And that's what started me thinking about the power of humor.
Wow. Wow. Well, thank you both for sharing your stories. I want to dive right in. I love the subtitle of the book, which is Why Humor is a Secret Weapon in Business and in Life. I love to laugh. I've noticed that my sense of humor has evolved over the years from what I would used to describe as witty to now more like dad jokes, but that's a story for another day. I guess that's what happened. I do want to start with Naomi, you, in how you teed this conversation up, that you split your day with comedy and then also innovation. John and I have spent most of our careers on the front lines of innovation and could probably attest to how little humor there's been in that work. But what was the light bulb that brought that together for you?
Well, and it really was a light bulb moment for me, because as I said, it was, I actually believed the opposite. I thought that I had to be really serious and really professional all the time to accomplish big goals. And I had this moment with a client where I was up at the front of the room, I was giving a presentation, and he sort of said a snarky line at me. And without thinking, I shot back with a snarky line back. And I felt the dynamic of the room shift. And not only did I gain power in that moment, but everyone sort of relaxed and everyone, you know, was able to participate in a better way. And so I started in these little ways trying to incorporate humor into the work I was doing. So I'll give an example. I had co-designed and was co-facilitating a wargaming simulation for a board of a $2 billion company. And so we were doing this simulation. And by the way, wargaming, as you guys know, and as the listeners probably know, is you essentially take on, you have the board members take on the personas of some of their great biggest competitors in the market. And so you answer the question, if I were this competitor, how would I tear down the company? Not necessarily an exercise known for its humor. But what we decided to do was have little costume bags in every corner of the room. So the group that was supposed to be taking on the Silicon Valley persona got to their area and there's this weird bag. And so they open the bag and there are red hoodies in the bag. And they're like, what are we supposed to do with these red hoodies? You know, I walk by and I'm like, oh, well, you're the Silicon Valley tech crew. So, you know, better get in character. So there was this moment of like, oh, we're too serious for this. We don't want to do it. But then one person picked up the hoodie, put it on. Another person picked up the hoodie. And then the tone just shifts. They're like laughing. They're putting up their hoodies. You know, they're sitting in their chairs differently. Their body language changes. And you just hear the laughter in that corner of the room. And then the ideas start to come more easily. So we would do things like, you know, at their final presentations, rather than raising your hand if you think that there's a really important insight, we would have cowbells that people would ring, right? Someone would say a really important insight and someone would ring a cowbell. And so it's this lighthearted way of accomplishing the same thing, but doing it in a way that we know will unlock our brains in more creative ways, will get the group more trusting and more cohesive more quickly, and will actually impact how innovative we can be in the room.
Wow. Okay. So, John, I'm going to squeeze in maybe one more question before I turn it over to you. And that is, well, first I'll just say that John and I took the humor quiz, and I think we were both magnets. John, is that correct?
That sounds about right. But I haven't looked at it in a while, so yeah. I'll trust your memory, not mine.
We took it right after. Oh, actually, we took it right before. January 6th, if I'm not mistaken, and the whole world sort of changed right after that. So the question that I want to just jump into and tee it up for John is I know that we know the power of humor in our life. In fact, sometimes I laugh so hard, I just don't even have to do sit-ups for a week. the power of humor in business, where there is a culture, there's a hierarchy, there's sort of structure to meetings, you know, how do you convey the power of humor in sort of a business sense? And then I'll just kind of wrap that up with what's holding us back from sort of accelerating the adoption of humor in the workplace?
Yeah, so I'll start. You know, it was so fascinating because when we dove into the behavioral science as well as the neuroscience, and started talking to, you know, CEOs, leaders, individuals, we found three interesting things. One is humor seems to have this incredible transformative effect on not just our behavior, but our psychology, on our mental health, our creativity, our feelings of closeness, and even our sense of meaning in life. Two, it's completely under-leveraged at work. Our workplace is far too humorless, and that was before us shifting to remote work. With Zoom, it's become even more challenging. And third, it's a completely learnable skill. Many people think that you're either funny or you're not funny, but that's actually not true. So let me just throw out a few statistics that kind of underscore the return on investment at cultivating this, both within yourself, but also in your teams. One, when people use humor at work, and it doesn't even have to be good humor, just not inappropriate humor, they're seen as 23% more respected and seen as more competent and more confident. And again, it doesn't even have to be good humor. For employee retention, employees who rate their bosses as having a sense of humor, they report to be 15% more satisfied in their work and more engaged. And they rate their bosses as 27% more motivating and trustworthy at a time where we're looking at a really significant trust gap globally. And in sales, studies show that people on average pay 18% more if you throw in a humorous line. So one of our favorite studies, there is a research assistant who came into a lab and either asked someone, they were going to negotiate with a piece of art or on a piece of art, and said, my final offer is X. Or the research assistant said, my final offer is X and I'll throw in a pet frog. And in the latter condition, people paid 18% more for that piece of art and said they enjoy the negotiation task much more than in the first condition. They felt closer to the research assistant as well. So we could go on and on about this, but a lot of this is, you know, neurological. What happens is when we laugh together, and again, as you said, with your dad jokes and your propensity to laugh so easily, what happens is there's, you know, neurologically we shift. There's a chemical release, a healthy cocktail of endorphins, dopamine, and oxytocin. And so when that happens, and oxytocin, as you know, is the hormone that's released during childbirth as well, and even sex. And so sex, childbirth, and laughing together with a colleague on Zoom have, you know, things in common. Not just oxytocin release, but, you know, no one's wearing pants. We'll be here all night. Thank you very much.
We all agreed that we were not wearing pants for this interview,
yes,
right?
Yes, I am wearing pants.
This cuts off right here, yes.
Okay, that's yeah.
Right.
So I think that you like the subhead, and we do too. It really is about, it's a secret weapon that's under leveraged, and even my dog in the background agreed.
I have this slide that I use in presentations that I tried to be creative, but I got stuck in Zoom meetings all day. And it just it reminds us that we have to make time for these things that make us feel better. And goodness, we all know that those same ingredients in a healthy cocktail can also be in an unhealthy cocktail that we're so overdosed with in terms of social media these days. And we need to find more productive and healthy ways to balance our lives. So with that, John, over to you, my friend.
So I have a couple of burning questions.
Burning questions.
Yeah. The first one comes from my own experience. When I started teaching at a well-known East Coast business school many years ago, I went around and talked to senior people and said, well, what are your tips for being successful in case method teaching? The response, the pearl that I got that I remembered and thought about and actually used, and I'm wondering what you think about it, was the advice was go watch a lot of stand-up comedians. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that was because stand-up comedians know how to put their attention into the audience. You know, most of us when we perform have our attention within ourselves, we're nervous. You know, we're full of thoughts as opposed to responding to what's going on outside of us. Mm-hmm. And of course, in case method teaching, you have to be alive to the moment and you have to be reading language, body language and the vibes and everything else. So to what extent is your leveraging humor for business also relate to cultivating that kind of attention or mindfulness? And does it come up in the way you, you know, impart your gifts to your audiences?
Absolutely. There's, you know, we were talking to Kelly Leonard the other day, who's runs the Second City. And he was talking, you know, he's seen Stephen Colbert and Amy Poehler and Keegan-Michael Key all come through Second City. And so he has this incredible pattern matching of what makes someone a successful comedian. And what he says is the common trait is that they are all relentlessly present, that there is something about humor that requires us to be present in the moment, incredible listeners, reacting to what's going on. And comedians will say comedy is a conversation between the comedian and the audience. It exists in the space between the two. And in fact, you'll see a comedian deliver a different set if they're in a small venue in San Francisco versus in, you know, somewhere in rural Texas. And so that's one thing. What we also know is that comedians are masters at using some of these techniques that simply make us better, more compelling communicators. And so when we analyze some of what comedians are doing, we're also analyzing what makes people pay attention, what makes information stick, and of course, how do we land, you know, in a way that's gonna make people laugh. So in our book, we actually break down in a chapter called The Anatomy of Funny, where we look at what is it, how do we dissect what comedians are doing that makes them so effective? And one really simple thing is looking for observations from your life and then applying some techniques like exaggeration, contrast, rule of three, build out the world. All of these are actually really simple techniques that are incredibly effective at making other people listen to what we're saying and remember it later.
Yeah, it's interesting what you say. I guess another cardinal skill set that I would wonder about in relation to humor is improvisation. You know, when I got to be on the Colbert Report late in his run, and so I got to spend some time with the man himself. And we talked a lot about the connection between jazz and stand-up. And he said that in his time at Second City, the language that they used to describe their work was drawn to a significant degree from the world of jazz, you know, in terms of riffing and, you know, all of the other lingo that goes into improvisation. So does improvisation show up in your, you know, kind of corpus of knowledge and offerings as well?
Absolutely. I mean, so my background, I have a deep love for improv. So that's sort of what got me into this world. And yeah, I mean, there's a lot of the techniques that you see in stand-up are similar in improv, but it's actually quite different skill sets to get there. So you talk about, for example, the concept of yes and this is obviously so present in the innovation world as well, which is that whatever gets thrown at you is exactly the right idea. And all that you have to do to create humor is say the next true thing in that moment. So you're not looking for what's funny. You're not looking for the one-liner. All that you're looking for is just what's true, because often what resonates with people, what's going to make them laugh is that truth. So we talk about all humor incorporates some aspect of surprise or of truth and misdirection. So this is actually a really common misconception with the executives we work with is they'll say, okay, I'm giving this big talk. How do I be funny? And we say, no, don't tell me what jokes you want to tell. Tell me what's true about your life. So we'll interview them. I was talking to an executive the other day and I said, well, just tell me about your life. What's your home life like? What's your family like? Where's tension in your life? And he goes, well, you know, he's telling me all these things. And then he says, my kids don't listen to me. I was like, that's great. Tell me more. Tell me more about your kids not listening to you. This guy is a high powered CEO. He's a well-known person who he walks into a room and everyone listens to him. Right. And I'm like, tell me more about that. So we got to this point where he realized there's this area of contrast in his life where at work, he's a high powered CEO. Everyone listens to him. And then he goes home and he's essentially an underpaid executive assistant to a 13-year-old, right? So he's like racing around the house, trying to cater to her in any way that he can. And that's where you find really authentic humor that humanizes, that that builds connection is not in the perfect one-liner. It's in these aspects of truth and vulnerability in our lives and bringing those to the surface more often.
So imagine that the two of you walk into a room and there are a bunch of senior people and there's going to be a very short excursion into the power of humor in business. And you mentioned earlier that this was teachable, learnable stuff. Although we know that people who are really good at it probably have practiced a lot. So in that scenario, what are the two or three most important or salient things that you could share with them that would make humor actionable? In other words, you know, what's the kind of two or three take homes or Monday morning things that I can take that as a tool and work with it?
Yeah, so the first thing we do, which we invited you to do as well, is, you know, there's this feeling that A, I'm not funny, which B is untrue. Like when you, it's not about being funny, it's about being human. I think that humor is basically comedy or being this kind of stand-up. So you have to disabuse them of that idea and start to show not just the ROI of it, but also how it actually is showing up in their life. So Naomi talked about one technique, which is just starting with mind your life. And then you find the truth, and then you start to practice these techniques like exaggeration or contrast or rule of three, which we get into in our chapter three of the book. Mm-hmm. But another super important thing is this idea of just finding out what your own authentic humor style is. You mentioned both that you were a magnet. So let's just describe really quickly the four styles, because each of them have strengths and each of them have weaknesses or risks associated with them. And it's important to not only just know your own authentic style, but be able to read the room, understand others so that you can better calibrate where are the potential risks, because that's what also holds leaders back in ways that it doesn't have to. So the four styles based on 5 years of research are the stand-up, and this is your classic funny person. They're more extroverted. They're not afraid to have a line that might cross or have a joke that might cross the line. And then there's the sniper. They're edgy. They're dry. They're witty. Again, they might also be close to crossing lines, but both of those types oftentimes tease in order to, because they kind of like you. We'll often hear stand-ups and snipers say, I tease in order because, you know, I feel, you know, comfortable with you. Then there's the magnet, which you guys are. And they
tend to- out, by the way, I just looked at my results and I'm a sniper. 42%.
Oh my gosh. Okay.
Well, you're a sniper, John.
7% magnet, 42% sniper. So let me correct the record right away.
Oh, we love snipers. In fact, one of the our co-authors are on a piece who is a guy named Joel Stein. He just finished a piece around our work, and he is definitely a fantastic sniper. So is my dad, Brian, as you might have noticed, I'm not sure on the previous podcast, but then there's the magnet. So they're gregarious, they're charismatic, they often uplift, and then they bring people together. And then there's the sweetheart. And they tend to, they would never use humor to actually offend. They tend to be more fun or upbeat rather than funny per se. What's interesting about this is that each style has a risk associated with it. So for example, stand-ups and snipers tend to have the greatest risk of offending or alienating, and sweethearts and magnets are often at the greatest risk of taking away their own power through self-deprecation. So we can go into more details, but it's really fascinating. Naomi, why don't you share the other two tips?
All right. So I would say the three quick tips would be, number one, know your humor style. So you can either listen to the ones that Jennifer just mentioned, or you can go to humorseriously.com, take a quick quiz and know your style. Number two, this one's really simple. For 7 days, write down at the end of each day the three funniest things that happened that day. And this, at day one, you're going to think that your life is pretty boring. In fact, one of our students said, on Tuesday, I did not laugh, not once. Who knew a class about humor could be so depressing? But what you'll find is that by the end of day seven, you'll start to have more laughter and joy in your life. And this is not because you're funnier. Obviously, you have no other skills that we're giving you. But the priming effect in psychology says that we find what we set out to look for. And so when we are primed to find humor and joy in our lives, we will actually find more of it and create more of it. So tip two, end of each day for 7 days, write down the three funniest things that happened. And then tip three would be, this one's really easy, be more generous with your laughter. We talk about navigating your life on the precipice of a smile. And we know that when people laugh more at work, especially in senior leadership roles, as Jennifer mentioned earlier, they're seen, they're more motivating, their employees tend to report being more engaged, they're reported as higher in status. So especially for senior people, think about just being more generous with laughter. Now I'm gonna give a bonus tip for people who are who really wanna overachieve, and that is, we have a whole chapter in our book about using techniques from comedians. So I'm gonna give you one technique that you can use in the coming week. So that technique is called the rule of three. All you do in the rule of three is you make a list of three things, four things, actually five things, anything. But the key is that last element has to be a little bit different than the other elements. It has to be a little bit surprising. So I could say, you know, I wish that we were all in person, you know, right now. And I because things would be so different, right? We would have supportive eye contact. We would go for a coffee chat after the interview. We would all be wearing pants, right? So it's one, two, and then apple at the end. So rule of three is a really simple technique. If you think of something funny, but you're not sure how to craft it, try that.
You know, if I bought the book authored by every one of our guests since we started the show, it'd be a significant financial event in my life. So I don't. But I'm definitely going to go out and get your book. I'm very curious. I'm curious to explore in my own mind some of the links between creativity and humor, which are well documented in the literature, going back to Arthur Koestler and, you know, the theories of association, and then also try to relate what I anticipate you're going to be saying in the book to the whole improvisation topic. Having written a book a century ago on what leaders can learn from jazz musicians, maybe I should be saying, or you're saying, what leaders can learn from comedians in a way. I mean, or right.
Absolutely.
That's what you're doing. So thank you very much. And back over to you, Brian, for any closing thoughts.
Well, Naomi, Jennifer, thank you so much. I really enjoyed this conversation, and both John and I will give you our feedback after we complete the book. I'll just leave us all with a quote here from Sir Ken Robinson, may he rest in peace, which is, creativity is as important as literacy, and we should treat it with the same status. So thank you, Naomi. Thank you, Jennifer. Until next time, John, as always, what a pleasure to be on this show with you. I am going to share with you, though, John, something very funny that that just popped up on Newsweek. I think you might appreciate this. It's an article about about a tweet, and they picked up my response to her, and I feel like if you're going to tweet, do so to expect people to see it. I was trying to introduce introduce a little humor. And what I was aiming at wit to a conversation, just as a means of getting people to see that, you know what, sometimes we have to take a step back in order to see the world differently and appreciate the world differently. And as always, John, I appreciate this time with you. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Please do subscribe to our newsletter. We had a meeting about it earlier in the week, so we're about to get that going. Also, please tune in to past episodes. We've had some amazing guests so far at intersectionslive.com. For those asking about the book, it's called Humor Seriously, and we'll share some links here on the platforms. John, any parting words?
No, I'm looking forward to next week. And also, I believe next week we have a doubleheader coming up. So Tuesday at 10:30, we have some additional guests in addition to our regular Thursday show. And I think the reason for the supplemental, at least for one of the guests, is because of the absolute timeliness of the topic. John Arquilla, distinguished professor of defense studies at the U.S. Naval Postgraduate School, has been doing a lot of very high quality thinking about the cyber issues, the incursions, the solar wind fiasco and others, and has a very fresh point of view on it that we want to share with our audience. So it's an embarrassment of riches. You know, we're going to be on twice next week, and you'll all be hearing about it through social media.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that, John. It's really important. It's a topic that it's one of those among the many that we're probably going to start hearing more about now, that we can focus our attention on fixing and unifying. So with that, everybody, we'll see you twice next week. Thank you so much. And until then, if you have any questions, please do reach out. We're here for you anytime. Cheers, everyone.
See you, Brian.
See you, John.